Today is Tuesday, March 23rd, and you're listening to the Zombie Dust Radio Hour. The Zombie Dust Radio Hour. I'm your co-host, Mike Shalau, aka Dusty. I'm here with your other co-host, Eric Capron, aka Buster. How you doing, Buster?
What up? It's your boy Eric. I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm great. You and I have been kind of banging out the Zombie Dust Radio Hour every week for the last 8 years.
It's been 8 years, yeah.
At least 8 years. Yep. This is episode, like, I think 463.
That's right.
And we are stoked that we're finally going to release the second one, because we've been recording them in Studio B here at the Co-Prosperity Sphere.
Yes.
And Jamie has said that none of them are good enough to put on air, so pretty stoked to have the second one on air, even though he wouldn't know if it's good enough yet. I want to give a big shout out to our sponsor today, the Beer Cellar, and Dave Hawley, for without his encouraging words of the first episode of the Zombie Dust Radio Hour was the worst podcast I've ever heard, we wouldn't be here today. So
thank you to them. Mm-hmm. Thank you to their two separate retail locations in Geneva and Glen Ellen.
Yep. Big great shout spots.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, thanks to Dave. Thanks to the Beer Cellar. Shout out to them. Shout out to everybody out in that area. Shout out to Geneva, Batavia, St. Charles, the whole region. And thank you guys. Yeah, you know, the lost episodes are kind of like the Bob Dylan basement tapes.
They'll come out.
They'll come out eventually. Mm-hmm. And to, you know, a lot of critical acclaim.
When we sell our catalog for half a billion dust coin, they'll come out. They'll be clamoring for it.
Absolutely.
Be part of the deal.
And we'll slow roll them out too. We'll probably do some limited vinyl pressings, some CDs, some cassettes.
Yeah.
We'll have all sorts of formats for everybody to enjoy.
Probably some green vinyl.
Some splatter vinyl too.
Some splatter green. Some tie-dye vinyl.
Some shatter vinyl.
Shatter vine.
Absolutely.
Nice.
All the vinyl variants will be out there. And you know, we're just excited for these episodes to come out, and we only bring it up now because, you know, it has been a while since our voices have actually graced the airwaves, but we've been out here.
We've been out here.
We're
putting in the work.
Yeah. Citra doesn't go away.
No.
And neither
Citra
do
don't
we.
Stop.
And neither does the Zombie Dust Radio Hour.
No. And some of you might've thought the Zombie Dust Radio Hour might've gone away because of happenings in, you know, alternative currencies, cryptocurrencies, if you will. The whole collapse of FTX, which, you know, your boy Eric and I were heavy into at the Dust Coin.
Maybe too heavy, almost too heavy.
You know, we gave the amphetamines to Alameda Research. I probably shouldn't say that on air, but something has to be said. And, you know, all the FT token that they're claiming they had on their balance sheet to cover everyone's deposits is actually Dust Coin.
Yep.
So
if you think about the two letters in, I think it's in Greek, it's ZD.
That's right.
Right?
Sure. Yeah.
I believe so.
Definitely.
So, you know, not a lot of people know that. And, you know, we've asked them, and I think through our lawyers have been advised to not really disclose that information.
We'll disclose it anyway, though. And a lot of people, you know, in CoffeeZilla or, you know, online, people investigating what happened to FTX think Binance had something, was like the big domino that fell. But really, the inside scoop is that we took all of our Dust Coin out of FTX before the collapse.
Well, I mean, technically, it felt like the right time for us. I would not say there was any sort of insider trading whatsoever.
Absolutely. Well, I don't even know who said insider trading.
No, I know. I just want to be clear.
Yeah,
with everybody.
I'm glad we found a good place to stash it, though.
Yes.
We moved all of our Dust Coin to Silicon Valley Bank.
Yep. All our assets are there.
Mm-hmm.
Every last drop.
Every last drop of dust has been deposited in Silicon Valley Bank. So We're good.
And we feel great about it.
Just a great partnership.
Absolutely.
I think Peter Thiel's getting in the game.
Hopefully.
He said he's going to hold, like, Diamond Hands, Dust Coin to the moon. So we got that going for us.
I don't even know what you're talking about.
Are you not reading the emails and the memos I'm sending every week with the rundown of what we're doing on the podcast?
I just send them to my assistant. That's really as far as it gets.
That's fair. That's pretty good. That's a good way to do it.
So, but I think where you're going with that, Mike, is that, you know, the collapse of some forms of crypto did have an impact on us.
Right.
Obviously.
Right.
And I think that
you positive.
Yeah. But exactly. It was actually positive for us. And, you know, we're really excited about the position that we're in, really excited about the future. We've never ever pulled off the gas when it comes to buying Dustcoin.
No, the volatility is as high as ever. But as usual, it's almost only as volatile as how much it's going up every day.
Yeah. And it's just continues to be a buyer's market.
Volatile up and to the right.
Exactly.
Now, with the success of something like Dustcoin, there's going to be imitations, right? Or there's going to be a rush to the space.
Yep.
Like your Doge coins.
Yep. The meme stocks.
Right.
And AMCs. I think
Zombie Dust has seen something similar, right? Where zombie dust is zombie dust, and there's always going to be zombie dust, and it's always going up and to the right.
Yes.
But there's a new zombie brand.
Are you referring to the zombie dust 19.2 ounce stovepipe can?
That's one innovation they've come out with recently.
There's a few things. There's been a few changes in the space since we've been on air.
Disruption.
Obviously, we did a 32-part series about zombie dust being in cans.
Deep dive.
Yeah. We did, I think, a 6-part mini-series about the transition to stovepipe cans.
The collab with John Oliver.
Yes.
Yeah.
And now, as the space continues to evolve, we do have this first expansion to the brand. With zombie ice.
Yeah. So I got the freshest zombie ice I could find, the zombie dust stovepipe I could find at the Beer Temple. We're going to give it a little taste.
Which it is a really good batch.
It's a really good batch. It's no half full growler of Cenotaph.
No.
But it is a stovepipe of zombie dust from November. So yes. We're going to give it a shot.
One of the peak batches from the collection.
Yeah.
A really good vintage.
All the real dust heads know this is the number one stovepipe batch.
Yeah. When we did our year-end ranking, I believe this was in our top 30 batches.
Of stovepipe zombie dusts or of all zombie dusts?
Of all, if I'm not mistaken.
I think that's right.
Yeah.
It went Cenotaph, half-full growler of Cenotaph, 26 other batches of zombie dust we've had,
batch. Right, exactly.
Of zombie dust soap pipes.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we're gonna give it a little taste. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers, sir. Cheers. To all of our windfalls with SCB.
I mean, just right away.
That's Citra, baby.
That's that big Citra aroma.
You gotta have that big Citra aroma or else it's not zombie.
Yeah, I'm just getting notes of a little bit of Citra. A
little Citra, yeah.
Citrus. Also,
I'm getting that too. Some Citra and citrus.
Some like almost tropical, like a pineapple, like citrus
fruit. Mm-hmm. Tropical pineapple citrus. Little dank citrus, maybe.
Yeah, some light citrus notes, but like just so like a really tasteful, smooth finish.
Yeah.
Like cotton candy.
Cotton candy, maybe a little like if. Like Necco wafery, cardboardy, candy, citrusy thing.
Mm.
That's up there.
Yeah, I this is hitting all those notes for me.
So if we're gonna, this is obviously not financial advice. It's just for educational purposes.
But buy now.
The 11/29/2022 Zombie Dust Stovepipe. We're going hard buy.
Cannot recommend highly enough.
We're going to go hard buy. Yeah, you can't get enough. Can't buy enough of this for your portfolio.
So this reminds me a little bit of, I think it was the July 8th batch.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if you recall that one.
Yep.
I was at a concert in Deer Creek, formerly known as Deer Creek, over in Noblesville, Indiana this summer. Mm,
your
and
favorite.
One of my favorite venues. And I was there having a good time, looking around. What am I going to drink? Normally my go-to, Bell's Too Hearted. Anytime I'm at a venue, I know it's going to pack a punch, but my head, I mean, I cannot imagine what it would have been like to see me, like, oh my gosh, I was freaking out. And then I was like, what's going on? I'm like, hey, they have zombie dust stovepipes here right now. Mm-hmm. And the rest of my night was set. All right. I know I texted you a picture from that night.
You absolutely did.
Yeah.
I bought all of them after that.
And yet, and I said, this is the one we have to go hard on. And that was like really, I think, August, September, we kind of coasted off that batch. It was a great mm-hmm. batch.
Yep.
And then our stock dwindled a little bit just from a little bit of, you
just
know,
didn't
head
go up
stash.
Quite as hard.
Right. And then, boom, they hit us with this November 28th?
29th.
Oh, that's my friend Casey's birthday.
Oh, what up, Casey?
And he's a huge Zombie Dust fan, just like myself.
Of course.
Yeah. I don't try to, like, think of myself as an influencer, financial advisor, anything like that. Like, you know, come on, stop it. That's not where I'm at. But I have been telling a lot of my friends, hey, you see these day codes, grab it.
Snap them up.
Grab it, stash it.
Now, our lawyers did say we shouldn't speak too much about the FTX thing.
Okay. I mean, I do remember that.
But a lot of the reason that we caused this big crash of crypto, potentially, allegedly, is because we heard about a potential freezing of our assets. And we wanted to make sure we were liquid. And I think it was just kind of a misunderstanding.
Exactly.
Because when we hear ICE, I assume you're freezing my dust coin.
Exactly.
So when it says zombie ICE, I'm like, well, if you're going to, I got to get these assets liquid.
Right.
But really what it was is it's the beer zombie ice. It wasn't that they were going to...
Huge misunderstanding.
The government wasn't freezing my assets.
Right.
So my bad, but worked out for me. So but we should probably try the zombie ice then too, right? Just to make sure it's not freezing our assets.
Yes, absolutely.
It doesn't say this on the box, but I'm pretty sure this is the world's first cryo crypto.
Is it? Do you know if this batch in particular was the one that's cryo crypto? Or
I think so. This is the March 3rd, 2023 batch. So
yeah,
you know,
very fresh.
Yeah, very fresh. Different vibe on the can, that's for sure.
Yeah, the color you're seeing on this one, it's a lot less bright and a lot less vivid, a lot more gray.
You know, if I hadn't done so much research, you know, into the stock, into the coin, this is blue. It doesn't scream Citra to me.
Right.
So I don't even know if I would have known there's Citra in it. I'm not even sure if it says there's Citra on it. Oh. No.
It doesn't say Citra?
I don't know if it's... Oh, no, there it is. Yeah. Crafted in an unholy amount of Citra hops. Yeah. With an unholy, so that's how you know. If you get that batch, the one with the unholy amount of Citra hops, that's the good batch.
What I do like about this can is it. You do get some ice elements on the font for the name of the beer.
Yep.
As well as the eyeballs of the zombie.
You know what I like is that it's like super topical with the Game of Thrones that I just started watching. And I finally got to like the 7th season, I think. So it's super topical for me that this came out now.
I still haven't seen it, if I'm being completely honest.
Game of Thrones?
Yeah.
It's good.
I don't know. I keep hearing that, but... you ready to dive in?
I'm ready to
the beer?
Yeah, I think we should check out our investment.
Undead Pale Ale.
Mm-hmm.
Heralds the zombie classic evolution after the dust has settled from the apocalypse. Kind of provocative when you think about it.
Yeah, it is.
Right? A little, like, really makes you think. You're like, all right, what am I going to get into here?
And what's the money after this apocalypse going to be?
Right. And, you know, obviously.
You know, I think this has
some recommendations.
This has won the GABF gold medal for Undead Pale Ale. It's like 10 years in a row, I think.
That's right.
The most undead.
So now they're just competing with themselves. Well, it's a undead double.
It's the double.
Undead double.
All right, so
8.5%.
That's a lot. That's a good percent.
I know. It's a big boy.
Let's get after it.
I guess probably.
So Oh, I'm smelling. I think it's Citra hops.
Big Citra nose.
Big Citra nose. Oh yeah.
I mean, these guys really are wizards when it comes to this.
Yeah.
Are wizards on Game of Thrones?
That's a good question. Yeah, I'm pretty sure there's at least one wizard in there for sure. I can't say no.
Okay.
Well, it's not like Lord of the Rings, bro.
Okay.
So less wizards than that for sure.
Okay. Okay. Wow.
I'm just getting a lot of like Citra.
You know, yeah, I'm getting a lot of Citra too. Some like orange, maybe some a little bit more pineapple as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm getting some like citrus on the palate that like follows the citrus on the nose.
I'm gonna say something a little controversial. I'm getting like a little bit of a pear finish. You get a little bit of that?
I think it's. I was getting citrus, but let me.
The citrus is there for me for sure. I'd say note one, note two, note three. Citra all the way through, but
wait, hold on. Can Citra taste like pears?
I think it's also it's like a fruit. So it
But does Citra is that what Citra tastes like?
Sometimes.
I don't want to sound like a dumbass.
Oh, you're fine.
All right. Yeah. I get pear.
A little bit of pear?
Yeah, definitely get some pear.
Just like in the finish though. It's like a
it's like subtle.
Like the fourth or fifth note.
It's like subtle.
Subtle pair.
Yeah. Can you name the three or four notes that come before that? So there's...
Personally?
Yeah,
like personally. That I get?
Yeah, that you're getting.
Sure. Let me... Yeah, so citrus.
Mm-hmm. I got that
too.
On the
aroma.
I got citrus too.
Definitely like a very citrusy... flavor and bitterness.
Mm-hmm.
The bitterness is nice.
Yeah, it's nice bitterness.
It doesn't even
it's
feel
like a citrusy bitterness.
It doesn't even
like a pithy.
It does. Yeah, it's like biting into an orange almost.
Yeah, they really captured that. I was actually tasting
some
citrus
yesterday.
It's
really great though. It doesn't feel like it's 8.5%.
Mm-mm.
I almost wish I had a little bit of like a citrusy alcohol heat.
Yeah, but, it's dangerous.
Right.
That's what they say.
But it's a smooth citrus finish.
Yeah. Well, you said there's pear in there, and there were four other flavors before the pear
and
the
this,
finish.
So
we got citrus.
Right.
Yeah. And then Citra probably.
And probably incognito Citra.
It's really hidden in there though.
And probably some Citra Cryo too.
Yeah. I'm guessing that's why it's called ice, right?
Yes.
Because they did ice distill it.
Yeah, I think so.
I'm pretty sure they ice distilled
I think so.
It. Yeah. Like the way that they make.
What color would you characterize this as?
Like somewhere in between like a tangerine and an orange peel kind of color.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
Like really citrusy colored.
Right. Like orange, like the fruit orange almost, you could
say.
Yeah,
almost.
Right, like the skin of an orange.
Yeah. Almost.
Like, yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do know what you're saying.
Right.
Yeah. This is, so, I know that we have a troubled relationship with this from the jump because of, you know, business moves we made because of a misunderstanding about it. But I think, where are you at on this? Are we a strong buy and hold?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
I
think we're a strong buy and hold.
I think for a risk like this, you think about getting in on the ground room floor.
Mm-hmm.
You think about Tesla,
right?
A Google,
yeah.
Get you know buying those stocks super cheap.
Yep, buying an Apple stock, you think it's actual apples,
right?
Then going to Vietnam, getting shot in the butt.
And then when you get ready to cash out 30 years later, and you're like, oh my, well, it's crazy. I'm a billionaire right now.
Oh my God,
what?
What? We're billionaires?
Like seriously?
Right now?
That's us. Like, yeah. I think we're so close to this. Like,
mm-hmm.
So I know the price has been very volatile, as you mentioned, all over the place.
Just all over the place up
but
and there, right?
I do think if you project out the potentials for something like this is the ground floor right now.
Yeah. I can't see it going any lower.
No way.
It's, I mean, it, the
it,
fact
it, will
that,
ne- it will never.
The fact that it entered at this value, it's a strong buy.
Strong buy. Buy and hold.
Hold. You buy as much of it as you can. Hold on to it as long as you can.
So I know you know this. You're obviously a dust head. You're following the dust times.
It's dust or bust.
This is in a variety pack.
It is.
With dust, ice, and then two other beers. Who cares?
Yeah. just throw those in the river. Yeah,
drink the other ones, whatever. But then you got to just hold on to this.
Right.
These dust and the ice.
I don't want to speak out of school because we're not even close to there yet, but this could be up there with the November 29th, 2022 batch of dust stovepipes.
Possibly.
You never want to, it's like fish shows, you know? Like, it's hard to say which one's the best one.
It's a little early to call it a classic.
Yeah, no. It might be recency bias.
Right.
But that's not really what we do. We're more like, gotta hang on to it for a minute. So, but it rips.
It's incredible.
Mm-hmm.
A 10 out of 10.
10 out of 10.
Might have to, reinvent the scale maybe.
It's an 8.5 out of 8.5, I think.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Think about how you want to speak about other options.
Yeah.
In relation to this.
I think that, well,
someone has to set the bar.
Right.
You understand?
So zombie ice, it's like, it's not at the top. Like, that would be November 29th, 2022 batch of stovepipes.
Definitely.
But this is like right below it.
It's right up there for sure.
So what would you say, like, the half and atop the scale? Half roll, full growler of Cenotaph.
Like, what would I rate it?
Yeah, like would that. You just give it one half full growler of Cenotaph. Like, how many half? Like, this is like a three.
This is like
0.37 half full growlers of Cenotaph.
It's like a 19.2 ounces of Cenotaph.
Of a half full growler of Cenotaph.
Exactly.
It's strong, you guys. We can't put it any clearer than that.
Yeah.
Well, great looking at our portfolio. We're gonna take a quick break. And we'll be right back with more of the Zombie Dust Radio Hour. Today is Tuesday, March 21st, and you're listening to the Beer Temple Podcast.
Remember, this is what we wanted. Remember, this is what we said. To never be heard or seen from again, 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 again. Remember, this is what we wanted. Remember, this is what we said. To never be heard or seen from again, 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 again.
Hello, and welcome to the Beer Temple Podcast. I am your host for the day, Mike Shalow from Iswas Brewing. Chris is off in California doing, we're not really sure what, probably complaining there's no fatheads. I think I said that exact same thing last episode. But it's probably true. He's probably complaining that the West Coast IPAs in California aren't dry enough. Anyway, sorry, Chris. Like to thank the listeners for tuning in on whatever podcast app you have, and also on WLPN. Thank you for having us on. Thank you, fierce leader Jamie Trecker. Today we are bringing back everyone's favorite series, the beer that changed my life. And today's guest is quite possibly the first person I ever met in the beer industry that I still know, even before I was in the beer industry. He began his beer career in the shop at Half Acre, and quickly rose through the ranks there, holding positions such as a vice president of packaging, sales representative, cultural coordinator, and events manager. During his time as the events manager, Half Acre was rightfully known as throwing the best parties in Chicago, hosting ambitious bangers like the annual Big Hugs release, the Big North, and Far and Away, which is still by far the best beer event I've ever attended. After his stay at Half Acre, he made a brief stop at Moore Brewing before joining the team at Phase 3, where he's now in charge of all sales and distribution. He is an excellent and dedicated softball player as well, despite his complete lack of ability to field his position at pitcher. He is my brother in dust and someone who I feel lucky to get to call my friend, everyone, Eric Capron.
Thanks for having me, Mike. Thanks for looking at my LinkedIn page.
That is where most of that came from. Also, from our friendship.
Also true.
How's your hand?
So healed, so strong. Recently decided to forego spring softball in favor of summer softball.
Okay.
So
real Sophie's choice.
Yeah. Didn't want to, like, you know, just throw myself back out there, throw the team back out there. There's a lot of people with a lot of stuff going on. That's not what I'm here to talk about, though. The night I suffered my one adult injury, you were there. So
that's right.
That was
I came
very
late.
Serendipitous.
I came late.
right after.
I rolled in after the game ended while you guys were drinking your juice boxes.
I think when you showed up, I had literally had my hand in a cooler on ice.
Yeah.
So I was like, yeah, I think this is like injury.
And it was like swollen.
It was bad.
And then we decided to go to Wild Goose and have a couple beers.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And think tater tots?
Probably.
And maybe some wings.
Yeah. None for me.
I think I ate the wings because your hand was too hurt to eat wings.
Yeah. Shout out to Liz. I'm sure she's listening.
Shout out.
The best.
Well, Eric, will you tell me about a beer that changed your life?
Yeah. Well, actually, what I was wondering was to deflect to you for just a second. Mm. Did you work at Binnie's before you worked at West Lakeview?
The other way around.
So you were West Lakeview first?
Yeah.
And then Binnie's?
Mm-hmm.
So I had to have met you at West Lakeview.
No, we met when I was still in college.
Really? So yeah. So even before you were working in the industry?
Yep.
Okay, so I guess I'll just jump into all this stuff.
We weren't good friends then, but...
Not necessarily, no. But this kind of does, it does all tie together, and... there's 60 hours of recording time, so
and we're gonna use all of them.
Yeah, I might get all the way through it, but so my journey through craft beer is completely related to my experience starting off as like a fan and an enjoyer of craft beer, but I was never someone who really knew much of anything about anything outside the window of what I liked.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so. I was in college. I had a kind of untraditional path to college. I worked, went to school part-time and then no time and then traveled for a little bit and then ended up going to community college and ending up at a four-year university for my bachelor's degree. And while I was going to school for my bachelor's degree in business, pardon me.
Getting choked up. You really love accounting.
Love accounting, love business administration.
I have a minor in business administration.
There you go.
That's probably why we get along so well.
Exactly. I know it.
All those long talks about business admin.
So I was going to school at ISU in Normal, and my now wife, former girlfriend, was was living in Chicago, attending college up here, living with a friend of mine. And, I dabbled a little bit in beer. Sierra Nevada Pale Ale was something that intrigued me, but it wasn't something that like flipped my lid, didn't like make it to where like, oh my gosh, this is like something I have to seek out. I enjoyed it when I got to have it, but it wasn't something that I was like obsessive over.
You were like, I gotta start homebrewing and make this.
Right, yeah. I really had no interest whatsoever. I was like, oh cool, this was a thing I enjoy, whatever. So I'm visiting my girlfriend at the time in Chicago. And she lived in Lincoln Park, as you do, and you move to Chicago. You have to live there at least once. And my friend was like, we got to go get some food to grill. So we biked up to Paulina Meat Market. And my friend was like, oh, there's a brewery up the street. We should go there. So we rode our bikes up Lincoln, stopped at there's a Jewel across the street, so we stopped at Jewel, got some buns, and then we went over into the brewery, which is currently Hop Butcher, but at the time was Half Acre. And I remember walking into the shop and had never really been to a brewery before. And the thing that blew my mind was it just smelled like weed. I was like, oh my God. Well,
that probably was weed.
It might have been weed. it probably was weed.
Who was brewing?
I don't know who was brewing, but In the shop was either, it was either Gabriel or Raj. Uh-huh. I don't remember which. Sure. But I remember someone, whoever it was like super welcoming, super friendly. And that's how I know it's not my friend Trent. love you, Trent. But I was like, what is going on in here? I was like, you guys like make beer with weed? They're like, no, it's just hoppy. Like, oh, okay. It's like, here, you want to try some?
You knew what
like,
that meant, right?
Like, yeah. Like, yeah, I know what that means. I had no idea what that meant. Because I never really had like a fresh pale ale or an IPA before in my life. Like, it was a totally foreign concept. It
didn't really exist in Chicago, that's for sure.
Well, it didn't exist in Bloomington Normal at the time either. That's there was a brewery surprising. There called IBC, Illinois Brewing Company, which is now defunct. And this... I don't know if this still was there yet or not. But
well, just an aside, you should never go too geographic with your name. You will not last. Illinois Chicago Brewing Company gone. Illinois yeah, Brewing Company
I remember,
gone.
I remember getting not all the way empty Chicago Brewing kegs when I worked at early on at Half Acre.
That was the tail end. We had Michael Roper on last week, and he said that was one of his most sad like breweries doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah,
we asked him.
I'm trying to even remember the brands they made. They were all pretty corny, name-wise.
Well, I think there was like an actual Chicago brewing company, and then there was one that like, just kind of like started contract brewing.
Yeah, by the time 2011 rolled around, they were definitely contract brewing.
Yeah.
I think we shared a distributor, too,
sure.
at the time. So anyways, so I'm like, what's this beer? What's this weed beer? And it's like, oh, this is Daisy Cutter. This is our pale ale. And I was like... you want to try some? And I was like, what you just for free? Whoa. And they're like, yeah, go walk around. And so like me and my girlfriend at the time and my buddy just like went and walked around at the brewery there. And I'd never been inside of a crap brewery before. And I was like, whoa, it's so cool. It's so small. It's just like a bunch of dudes hanging out, having a good time, making beer. And I was hooked. We got some growlers of Daisy Cutter because I think they were out of cans. At the time, this was summer 2020.
These are post Daisy Cutter bomber days.
This is post bomber. Yep. So that's how you know I'm not like OG. Like my cred is not like all the way there.
I never had a Daisy Cutter bomber.
Sure. I've had Daisy Cutter out of a bomber before.
Oh, no.
Yeah. You're not missing anything. It's definitely no zombie dust. I would not recommend aging Daisy Cutter. That's for sure. But shout out to our friends on the Zombie Dust Radio Hour.
They've been putting out. They've been just banging it out.
Yeah, I've got like a insight to a way to like get the feed kind of like a bootleg. Yeah.
You'll tell me about that.
Yeah, we'll talk about it after this. Yeah, we're done here. But so anyways,
did you get some of their vinyl?
No, not yet.
Okay.
I heard the test pressings are floating around, but yeah. I don't think they've actually like done the big one. But yeah. So Daisy Cutter was a beer that changed my life. After that visit to Half Acre, I started paying attention to craft beer, but really only one craft beer, and that was Daisy Cutter. So when I started, every time I would visit Chicago or my girlfriend would come visit me, I'd be like, can you bring me a four pack of Daisy Cutter, please? Because I just like couldn't get enough of it. And then a few months later, I graduated college, finally.
Congratulations.
And at the age of 26, whatever. Yeah. And my girlfriend at the time brought me two bombers of double Daisy Cutter and a growler. And I was like,
Doble Cotador?
Yeah. Like the second batch of that. And, nice. And that rocked my world. And I was just like obsessed ever since, at the time I was just like so obsessed. I like went to my family Christmas, like, hey guys, like craft beer. It's a cool hobby, right? And they're like, all right, cool. Have fun in the garage, man. So then a few weeks later, I was house sitting in Chicago and they needed someone to help them out in the packaging line. And I was such a fan of the beer. I was like, well, sure. I like the product. Why not see what happens and kind of go from there? And I hit it off with the owner at the time and got the job. And it's really the beer is not just life changing for me in that it is the reason I'm sitting in this room, but it's life changing in that, like, you know, it like helped my pay for my bills for like almost a decade of my life. So,
yeah. I mean, I don't think of it this way, but it's definitely a beer that changed my life as well. Like it is Half Acre's the brewer that got me into craft beer. not necessarily because I liked the beers even that much, but because I was flirting with your coworker. So
my first few days, at the time they wanted everybody to work in the shop to kind of get to know the vibe of the customers and get to know the vibe of what the retail experience at Half Acre was. And then from there, I was like, okay, if you can hang in this arena, then you can hang at any different area in the brewery. So they were growing so rapidly at the time that they needed to move people around into different areas. So I lasted like 2 or 3 days in the shop, and then I started working, cleaning kegs and working on the canning line. So,
well, I met you one of those days in the shop. I remember.
Probably. Yeah. And I was
still in college.
Yeah. And did you come on a tour at any point?
I went on that tour a dozen times. Maybe.
Yeah, for a long time it was free.
Yeah.
You know,
people would line up to go on a brewery tour.
So it's first come, first serve. Well, actually before that, I believe, well, I don't know, at some point they did reservations, but they got like reserved out for, I think, a year or something like that.
Yeah, it was crazy. So, but like, that's what happens when you only have one small brewery that's packaging within the city limits, or two maybe. There was like you and Metro,
but they,
Half Acre and Metro at the time.
Metropolitan, I don't even know if they did tours.
Yeah, I don't think they did.
Yeah.
Like, people think now that so much of the, you know, craft beer experience is going to a tap room, but that just wasn't even legal.
No.
In, what was that, 2011?
Yeah, so I started in January 2011.
And should we drink some of this beer?
Sure. It's been a minute since I've had it, I think.
Do you want to drink it out of the can, or do you want to drink it out of the, what's the vibe?
I'm a can guy.
Still cans.
Always have been. Thank you. When I...
Surge.
When I started, I've worked in food manufacturing and, you know, manufacturing overall on and off for over almost 20 years now, which is crazy to think about now that I say it. I've been, like, never really processed that.
Yeah.
But when I worked in food manufacturing, it was like very regimented for wearing gloves and aprons and hairnets and beer nets and stuff like that. But working in beer, I was like, it's not that big of a deal. I'm like, well, yeah, if you're putting like 4 packs of beer on a can and you don't do a good job, like washing your hands after you go to the bathroom, like you're, you know, touching where someone's going to put their lips. And I was like, that's a pretty good point. But I still drink out of cans.
Sure. Right. Sure. But it's not the same level of food safety as like if you're packing meat or something like that.
Nor should it be. All right. We don't want those regulators in our manufacturing space.
Stay out of here. Stop putting chicken in your beer and have them stay out of here. The first time I ever had this beer, it was in that tasting room. I don't know if it was the day you were working. It might have been before that. But I remember having it. I'd never really had craft beer before. And the friend who had brought me there, I leaned over to him. I was like, this is gross. Anyone that says they're liking this is just lying to themselves. And then I went on to work at a brewery that made mostly double IPAs for a really long time.
Yeah.
And I loved them very, very much. But
yeah, there's just time and a place for them, for sure.
Well, it's also one of those things of like the first time you have something like this, it's crazy. Like, it's very transformative. And like you, and honestly, I probably, this show obviously isn't about me, but I probably didn't like hoppy craft beer for months and months while I was still drinking it.
Yep.
Because there was something about it that was different and was clearly like creative and clearly not trying to be like a mass produced thing.
Sure. Do you think you choked it down because you knew that that was the best thing that was going, that was like new and different and like, I don't want to say on the cutting edge, but like, did you know that was like, okay, this is like what's popular, so I'm going to like give it a shot? Or like, what was your
reason
for drinking it?
When I look back at that now, I have much more perspective on myself both now and then and why I kept trying it. But I think I've never been someone who thinks that the organoleptic experience of something is the totality of the experience, right? Where if it's just hedonistically pleasurable, then it's good. And I've always been someone who has been kind of interested in things that I don't quite understand. So it's kind of those things going together where it's like, I didn't understand why this was like so intriguing to a lot of people. There was a cool vibe around Half Acre and I wanted to kind of understand better, like what is this and why didn't I get it? Yep. And then I over time, you end up like, I ended up really caring about it and really like loving this beer and other hoppy things. I've come around. I don't drink as much hoppy beer. I went through a phase of drinking basically only hoppy beer, but, yep. And then there was a phase of like, well, if it's hoppy, then it's good. And
sure.
Which is a different type of like not listening to my mouth. Where right. It's like, I remember drinking a Stone 14, like anniversary ale or something out of a bomber at a party in college and being like, this is so great. And then someone else took a sip and they're like, this is disgusting. And yeah. I was like, no, you just don't get it, man.
Right.
And now I look back and I'm like, probably was pretty gross drinking that out of like a lukewarm bomber.
You were just an arrogant bastard.
Yeah, that's right. I wasn't worthy.
Oh, boy. We sure have fun, don't we?
We do. So what's this doing for you now? How's it tasting these days?
You know, it's one of these things where like I was so, for such a long time, it was the only beer, or like I guess it really was the only beer I really got into for the first 2 years.
Sure.
I remember the first time going to Dark Lord Day, just basically going from, working in the shop to working in manufacturing and I remember going to a few bar events and being like, whoa, I can like eat and drink and not have to pay for it. That's so rad. I'm going to go to every single one of these I can.
Yeah. I know exactly that feeling.
So I remember like, The shift from that, like going to a bar event, like a beer dinner type of thing, to like going to Dark Lord Day. I mean, those two things couldn't be further apart.
Right.
Right.
Sure.
And that was my first like real exposure to the good and bad of what craft beer is, sure. I guess. I think the end of the spectrum that you could call it obsessive, or some other things. It was like that blew my mind. But also I think the part that really blew me away was how many breweries existed, because to your point earlier about, Chicago, like, for me personally, moving to Chicago was like such a huge leap of faith. It was like, I'm from a small, very small town of Central Illinois, to go from that to the third largest city in the country. It's like, a real leap, to try to like figure that out. And I think now not that big of a deal, but at the time I was pretty, pretty vulnerable and didn't know what to expect out of the world. So to then be so immersed in one brewery and one experience, like, oh yeah, like Half Acre. And then we got a few buddies like Metro and, Garrett and BJ will stop by every now and then, we'll go to Peace. Like that, but that's the whole scene. Right. And then to like go and see people with like 40 bombers of beer that are empty on the grass, of breweries you've never heard of, beer styles you never heard of. I never had a stout before going to that. like
yeah, the best, baby.
Sure. That's the something, that's for sure. But also to like go to a place like that and like giving a wristband, like, here you go, man, have whatever you want
for sure
all day long. It's like, but and you can bring in as much beer as you want. You're like, this does not seem responsible right at all.
I'm not supposed to be allowed. Me? I'm not allowed. I shouldn't be allowed to do this.
Yeah.
But there was something the Chicago craft beer scene then, of like it being kind of knowable, and you could like, mm-hmm. you could kind of get a vibe for each brewery that existed and kind of, I had this experience at one point where I knew every single brewery
yeah.
in and around Chicago,
same.
That packaged beer, and I knew a person at all of them.
Yeah, same.
Like,
yeah.
I had a personal relationship with someone at every brewery.
Right.
And then at some point in like 2014 or 15, it just like exploded and I didn't
yeah.
know anything anymore. Like, it's just such a, like, it went from being something that I thought I had a handle on and something that like I really felt like, all right, this is cool. And like, and the knowability of it increased my experience of it, right? Where you're yeah. like, I can like kind of keep all this in my brain. And then even just the local Chicago craft beer scene got to the point where it's like, and the national beer scene felt kind of like that, right? Where there were like a bunch of people like that, that were important and been doing cool things, and you felt like it was a knowable amount. And then at a certain point, just like it was just infinite. It could be a bazillion. It could have been, like 1,000, but just
right.
Not. I couldn't keep it all in my head anymore, and it was
no.
like, it changed the way I related to beer, to be honest.
So how do you approach that now? Are you, if you've seen someone at a fest that you saw at a fest 2 weeks ago, or that you saw like, you know, 10 times in the past 4 years, do you eat the humble pie and say, hey, I know we've met, my name's Mike, I'm sorry, I don't remember your name. Like, how do you go about that usually?
I'm very good with faces. I'm pretty bad with names.
Sure.
And
so you just say that?
No, I usually just pretend like I know who they are, to be honest. Like,
yep.
And like, I know more, like, it sounds like it's just a cop out, but I usually know so much more about those people than what their names are. Like, sure. I know like where they worked, like what they like, yep. And like how they like to interact, and like, I don't know, just like you know more about people than like you can put a name to them. That's just my cop out for not being able to remember people's names.
Yeah.
I should probably get better at just being like, hey, I forgot your name. But I had neighbors that I had for like 3 years. I learned their names and then forgot it and just never asked them again. So, that's a personal failing, but
I think for me, it's good to have someone around that I can introduce to one or the other person. Yeah,
that's the cheat code. You
know?
Yeah.
But if it's not the case, I've had to kind of eat the, you know, the pie of like, yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
It's just too much. And sure. I think that's a fair thing to say.
Well,
and it's not even like someone's unremarkable. Like, you can have a whole beautiful weekend experience at like a travel beer fest, or even just like a local beer fest, whatever it might be, run into somebody at a few events, and then, you know, see them 2 weeks later, you're like,
dude, absolutely. And like, it's more genuine just to be like, I forgot your name.
That's what I try. I've been trying to do that more and more.
And I don't think people are actually upset by it ever. Like, I'm never like upset if someone doesn't remember my name.
No.
But my world's also changed, right? Like, a lot of the time when I was working in beer, it was at a much more esteemed brewery that was doing a lot more of that stuff. And now, like, I work at a brewery basically by myself most of the time. We don't do a lot of events and things. So,
well, do you?
My circle's gotten way smaller.
Well, do you think that, like, because this is something I think about a lot, and I don't want to get like too in a weird zone. This is probably like the weirdest, lamest thing to talk about on a podcast, and I apologize, but
good way to start it.
Do you think like,
sorry, edit that out.
Like talking. So going from a brewery employee to a brewery owner, do you think that like how people like come to you changes like your approach? Like, they might know you more because you're Mike, the founder and owner of Iswas, versus like, oh, Mike from Pipeworks. You know what I'm saying?
I think because Iswas is such a like lower status, lower impact thing. No, like, I just don't have those interactions. Like, I don't get invited to the things that Pipeworks got invited to. Like, I don't have the opportunity. Like, I'm not going to like pour at the craft brewers festival in New York for Iswas, you know, or like, and honestly, more often people would recognize me from this podcast. I've had people like recognize my voice and stuff.
Wow.
This has a farther reach than me being at Pipeworks. But also, I did a lot of, like, you know, I gave 6 months notice before I actually left Pipeworks, and a good amount of that time, besides stuff, making sure everything was transitioning smoothly, was making sure I had a mental transition that was okay with going from, like, this, it was what I felt was, like, a pretty high-status job of, like, we're working at a pretty cool brewery at the time and running the barrel program and having kind of, like, like I had like a known nickname from that place, and like I prepared myself a lot for not having that identity,
mm-hmm.
and knowing that a lot of the things that I got to do and a lot of the things that probably a lot of the way that people treated me was not because of who I am as a person, but because of the station I held as like the representative for this, you know, brewery that won, you know, top 100 in the world kind of thing.
Yeah. And medals at FOBAB.
Sure. But I just prepared myself for that, and it was probably over preparation, but
sure.
I put a lot of my identity into what that brewery was and what it meant to be in that position.
And I know that feeling very well.
Sure.
I had had a different transition out.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, I ask cause like I, now that, when I would travel on behalf of Half Acre, I was never the brewer. I was never the owner, nor the founder, or anything like that. So like, I think you become almost like less memorable sometimes when you're like, oh yeah, like that's the guy, but sure, he's not the guy.
Sure. I mean, and also like the thing I do now, like I am the only guy.
Sure.
But I definitely see people treat me differently when they find out that like when they're like, are you the brewer? And I'm like, I'm like the only one.
Right.
So like it definitely levels up like their, which it shouldn't, but it does.
You should say you're the assistant brewer.
Yeah. I'm the delivery driver. Is it? I never do say that, but it's also true.
Right. Yeah. I mean, yeah, you're right.
When you were at Half Acre, you did that Far and Away event. Can we talk about that a little bit and like what that was like?
Sure.
Because it's the craziest, like of local events, it's the craziest, most ambitious thing any brewery's attempted by far.
Yeah.
I think it's even more ambitious and cooler than like FOBAB, which is an international like world, like, or at least countrywide festival.
Sure. Yeah.
Because you guys, and you did most of, you organized this, brought in 40 breweries from all over, 40 breweries minimum from around the country, and a couple from around the world.
Yeah.
Winemakers.
Yep.
Flew a producer or some representative from all those places into Chicago.
Yeah.
Put them up.
Right.
Rented some space, like, in Millennium Park.
Yeah.
And through what was the coolest beer event that I've ever been to anywhere, but specifically in Chicago.
Yep.
How'd you do that? Like what what was that like? Like, cause there are big breweries here, but like one's doing that.
Well, if I'm being honest with you, being the person who was able to go and attend a lot of beer festivals on behalf of Half Acre, you know, a lot of that was on the coattails of the founders and owners and head brewers and things like that. As people started to have kids, have families, have businesses to take care of, they weren't able to get out as often. And me at the time being married but childless, I was pretty willing to go and travel around and see the world and get to build connections with other brewers. And one of the things I realized by going to enough of these invitationals and beer festivals around the world was like, there's not an invitational in Chicago that like ties in any of the culture of the city of Chicago and the beer scene here. And also bringing, you know, showing off what the city has to offer for beer and just overall, you know, Chicago is a great town. It is
the best.
My favorite.
Mine too. I was talking about with someone this weekend.
I love it here so much. But I think Chicago at the time, pardon me, it maybe still does have, a bad rap. And, I was like, how come no one's ever done an invitational here? And also we should do an invitational here. So I was like, all right, let's do it. Like, you know, put your money where your mouth is. And, we started working on it in early 2018 after doing a few iterations of the Big North, which was like a brewery only. You know, I think to go back even further, the Big North initially, the initial concept, and this was more of Gabriel's brainchild in mind, but, you know, we were trying to always think about events that we could do that were going to, like, be memorable. Like, you can throw a tap takeover, you can throw a beer dinner, you can do any number of things, but how can you create something that's like a unique experience where the beer isn't the only part of what you buy a ticket for, you know what I'm saying? So trying to always find a unique setting, a unique concept, a unique setting and concept, blah, 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 for each event that Half Acre did, around Craft Beer Week, around anniversary, around any number of things. That was always like something we were trying to do. So did enough of those that were like Half Acre specific where I was like, okay, we've kind of got like a good team of people who can help produce this, but let's take it to the next level. Let's get all these people in. So we spent a really long time looking for the venue. That was the most important part in my mind. It's like, how can we showcase the city to people? in a way that feels good for people traveling and feels good for people attending the event. So landing a space at Millennium Park that was like a pretty blank canvas for us to come in and pretty much do whatever we wanted there, as long as we were in and out within the same day. They were very open-minded and pretty much let us run with it. So once we had the venue locked in, we kind of hit go time. We sent out paper invitations to all the breweries. The idea was that we wanted to only invite breweries who didn't brew beer in Illinois, which I was really nervous that we were going to get a ton of pushback from local brewers. But thankfully, like, everyone was really understanding. Yeah. I think that, like,
we hey, guys, wanted to go.
Sure. Well, not only that, but it's like, hey, guys, this weekend, there's going to be a big beer fest, but I don't want you to pour at it. You can come if you want,
yeah.
But, like, you don't have to pour. And I think a lot of people were like, oh, I can just, like, go drink good beer and hang out with my friends. That sounds awesome.
Yeah.
So the concept was kind of born from there. I think the initial idea was to bring in, I think we invited 80 breweries and ended up having 70 attend. I think we had a really good turnout rate for it. And, you know, from there, it was
70 breweries.
Some of them already had distribution in Illinois, so that helped. But for the ones that didn't, it was like, do you want to work with the huge Miller cluster and the, you know, the good and bad parts of their business, or do you want to work with a small independent one? We came to find out that the state registration paperwork for breweries to sell beer in Illinois was like really burdensome and was really expensive for anyone to sell any beer here, which I was totally ignorant to. And looking back, like, you know, I think that if I was ever going to try to do this kind of event again, I'd see if there was a way that we could change the laws or something to make it easier for people. Cause
if only someone's on the guild right. board that could get this change.
But at the time we didn't know that there right, it was right. like that, like much of a thing. And even, you know, if you're talking about sending 4 sixthels of beer, which is like the minimum that we brought in from everybody.
Yeah.
They'd have to pay $600 just to send that it. Beer here. It's like, that's crazy. And it was a charitable event too. And the idea was never to make a dollar. The sure. idea was like any proceeds that we would make, we would donate to someone that would help us like get the liquor license and all that kind of stuff. So I don't know how in the weeds you want me to get on this.
As deep as you want to go. Because I honestly, I find it fascinating.
Sure.
And it genuinely is the coolest, most unique thing I think it's ever happened to the Chicago craft beer scene.
Sure.
Well, I think at least as far as like events goes.
I think what made it so, the setting was huge. Mm-hmm. That space was beautiful. We wanted to do it in the fall. Summertime here can be oppressively hot and humid. And the idea was like in October, you never know. You could get snow. You could get sunny and 80. We ended up getting somewhere in between. It was like probably 50 degrees, maybe 45. Pretty nice weather. But once we got the setting locked in, it was all about who we could get. And fortunately, you know, Matt and Gabriel carry a lot of weight in the industry and have a lot of really good connections that they built up over time. Me, I've met some people and was able to call on some friends, Lee and Matt Young and all the other people that I kind of rose through the ranks at Half Acre with also were able to develop a lot of connections with a lot of really great breweries over the course of time. So, conceptually you're just talking about doing an invitational in Chicago, not that far of a leap, but what we found is the reason a lot of people had never done that was because of all the state paperwork and things like that that kind of got in the way and made sure. it more complicated.
But that naivete is the only way it makes that happen, right? Absolutely. If you knew all that stuff, you'd be like, ah, we can't do this. But.
Or like just find a way to like do it like illegally or something.
Sure.
Like,
right, yeah.
Which I'm sure people have done. I mean,
right.
I don't want to, yeah, there was a reason why no one had tried to do something like that in Chicago. It's because it was a huge
hard.
Pain. Yeah. So, but we didn't really know that at the time. We just went for it and it was ambitious, but also there was a lot of ignorance there. But, I think, it was a learning experience for everybody. And most people showed up, like the people that we invited, who went through the rigmarole of filling out all that paperwork with the state, they came out and had a really great weekend. going to an invitational like Firestones and some of the other, you know, best in the world, you see that the hospitality of the brewers is like really what makes it a memorable experience for the person traveling there. You know, you think about it, you sacrifice your weekend by going to a beer festival in another town.
No, it's like a vacation.
Yeah. Yeah. It's exactly like a vacation. It's
not vacation. We have to like wake
right,
up.
Not a work trip. Not a work trip.
Not at all.
You wake up early, fly, then have to go to an event, then go to bed, wake up, hungover, eat. And then, you know, we did two sessions. The only way we could even come anywhere close to being profitable was to do two sessions because the space didn't allow for us to do,
2 days
more than like 1,000 people per session. So, I think one of the huge takeaways for me was like how we marketed it. Mm-hmm. I think we were a little bit too high on our own supply and we thought like, oh, well, we can just like announce it in August and it'll sell out by October.
Sure.
I think since there was no proof of concept.
And you were trying to get 2,000 people?
That was the idea.
To buy tickets?
We bought 2,000 glasses.
I mean, you guys
we budgeted everything off 2,000 tickets. We sold nowhere near that amount. and became, you know, nowhere near profitable. But
most beer events aren't profitable is right. Like the secret of
that. And when I after the fact, I was like talking to my bosses and the accountants, I'd be like, but think of the marketing. Just like put it in the budget as like a line item for marketing. The idea was 2,000 tickets, two sessions. So, you know,
you guys only started marketing it 2 months before.
Yeah. Stupid. Very stupid.
Different times.
Yes.
It was different times.
Yes. If I could have gone, because the thing is like for the Big North every year, we would sell 1,500 tickets. I don't hope I'm not speaking out of school with that, but that was always the goal was to sell that many.
That's so many.
Just tickets. To try to, again, to break even on this event that was like just about having a fun time at the brewery. So we're like, okay, well, you know, a third more tickets for a much crazier event. Sure, let's go for it. Ticket price was higher. Unproven concept. I don't know that everyone who attended something like Big North was hip to something like Far and Away. And Phobab was like 3 weeks after. So you kind of like, you know, really had to eat into someone's like beer experience budget in order to either attend one or the other or both. So a lot learned from that. If I was ever going to do it again, would definitely market it much differently.
Sure.
But
you're proud of it though, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, you have good fond memories.
Absolutely. Yeah,
because you should. It was like the most incredible thing I've ever seen anyone pull off event wise in Chicago beer.
Pulling it off on its own. Yeah. It's like a pretty memorable part for me.
And you said you invited 80 breweries and 70 of them said yes?
Yep. Yeah.
Who were those 10?
I'm happy to talk about a few of them,
I was mostly kidding, but
no.
That's an incredible success rate.
I agree. And I think that just kind of speaks to the weight that Matt and Gabe have and Half Acre has or had, I don't know, in the industry. I think that there's a lot of clout there. I think, having a beer like Daisy Cutter as like the introductory. I mean, I think if you put, 50 brewers in this situation where they're talking about beers that like were, you know, a big deal for them or transformative or whatever, I would have to imagine at least a few of them would mention this, you know, Daisy Cutter.
For sure.
That's how I was able to develop a relationship with someone like Nick from True. It's like that beer when he went to Siebel was like his beer and like he was, you know, really into it too. And similar to you, doesn't really make these kinds of beers, but it's something that, was memorable for him and changed his life. So, I think that people who weren't able to make it for the most part were like, they responded and say like, yo, like we got a brewery expansion going on. The timing's not great. Or yeah, we can't fly over from Belgium. Sorry, but thanks for the invite. Like everyone was cool about it. I don't think there was really anyone who didn't respond.
You got the goat though.
Yeah, we did. and the thing about that was we didn't know he was coming until the week of.
And Yvon DeBates.
We had the De La Son himself.
De La Son. And so also like you guys didn't just throw that one party. There was a pre-party.
Yeah, the pre-party was huge.
And then there was an after-party.
also a thing.
Yeah. And so I remember I went to the pre-party.
Yep.
And I don't...
At Balmoral.
And I don't actually... I don't consume marijuana all that frequently. But I was there with my, our coffee friends, our Dark Matter coffee friends, and they gave me chocolate.
Yeah.
And
they,
I...
They were... That was very... That was very available.
Like a dummy thought it was just chocolate, and I ate it, and I was like, oh, no.
Yeah.
So I was... So
we actually had a weed sponsor for the fest.
Really?
Yeah. Nature's Grace and Wellness was our sponsor.
That's amazing. That's pretty early for that.
I know. And looking back, like, you know, I talk to people who still put on these invitationals and these festivals. Advertisers have such a huge part in helping... making something break even financially.
Right.
Because of the expense of, you know, putting people up in hotels and buying the beer, and because people want to send their best stuff. You know, it's really expensive.
Right. And you're not going to be able to throw an event like that if it's donated beer or you're not paying for the hotel rooms or the flights and stuff like that. Like it's just, isn't going to happen.
So I think that that's what made the turnout rate what it was like, We didn't fly people in, but we did buy the beer and we paid for the hotel. We didn't set a limit on what we would pay for the beer. Learned a lot from that. And learned we'd probably change it up in the future. But I think we didn't want to limit people because we knew they were going to be sacrificing a weekend to come hang out in Chicago. So we wanted
what a sacrifice.
But it was like, you know, you want to make sure that people are going to bring what they really want to represent themselves with.
Right.
So like, you know, Monkish brought a milkshake, cookie, double IPA, milkshake, double IPA or something like that. And like a other like hazy. And it was like, yeah, these are dope. I've never had a cookie milkshake IPA,
right.
But this is weird.
It sounds trite now, but that was cutting edge.
I mean, not to like be that guy, but like in 2018, it was definitely a thing, but it wasn't like as prominent as it is now.
Right.
And
you were going to try it from like the places that like started it or were the peak of that point.
Right. I think we were a little bit ahead of our time with doing that event too. I think that...
go on.
Like... in 2019 and early 2020, you started to see more brewery invitational start happening. And I think that they're kind of ramping back up now and are probably back to the norm, if you will. But I think we were like probably just a tiny sliver of like before it became to be such a thing. I think Microphone was doing Smells Like a Beer Fest by then. I think they did their first one in either 2017 or 2018.
Interesting. I don't even think about that.
I think conceptually they're similar. It's an invitational put on by a brewery in Chicagoland. But I think what made Far and Away more memorable was it was like Chicago is just as much of an attraction here as the breweries,
right?
As everything else. And the, it's right off of public transit.
Right.
It's another huge part of it. It's like, okay, how can we get people safely here and home? All the hotels and the after party, everything except for the pre-party is within walking distance. And you could just stay within that bubble of Chicago, really in like the more touristy neighborhood of the city and get to check off a lot of boxes. The Art Institute's right there and all that. So
the Bean.
Yep. The Bean's right there too. The pavilion's right there, William Park, obviously, the whole thing's right there. So it was quite an experience for me. That was an insane weekend. I remember being very tired at the end of it.
I can't imagine.
And then like being really proud, like kind of something I learned in my as I was planning my wedding with someone, I don't remember who, and I'm really sorry, but someone was like, you got to take a minute with your wife and you got to take a step back and you just need to soak it in what's happening. Cause otherwise you will never, it's going to come and go.
Right.
And if you don't realize like the totality of what this is in the moment, what was the point?
Feel the whole reason you're throwing this party.
So to like take a step back and just kind of like look with at the Chicago skyline in the background, look at like, you know, Tim Zawada DJing for both sessions, who I wouldn't have even known about if I hadn't like started hanging out with you guys doing this podcast and hanging out with Edmar and everything like that through Lumpen. Like I wouldn't have known about Star Creature and I wouldn't have known about anything like that. And it was like the perfect tone set for the vibe for the day for both sessions. Just like good music, upbeat. It was a local DJ playing awesome music. And like that like trying to bring as many like true, genuine Chicago experiences without it feeling like we're hitting you over the head with a hammer was massively important. And I think that's, at least for me, like looking back on it, like I take a lot of pride in it because I had a lot of hand in helping guide it. I wasn't the only person by any means.
I thought that's what you were saying. You were the only person that.
But like once all the details kind of got lined up, like the city overall just kind of took it over for us, and just having all those like local flourishes was massively important. And I'm a transplant. I've lived my whole life in Illinois, but not in Chicago. So sure.
Is that like your fondest event memory of your time there?
I mean, I think I take the most pride in that.
Is it that? And then giving Chris an edible and having him wake up on the railroad tracks and
I'll never forget that. I'm really proud of Far and Away for sure. I think my favorite events that I went to that Half Acre did, I think the ones that I look back the most fondly on are the ones I didn't have to do all the work on.
Sure. On Photon.
I didn't even get a non-Photon. I got the when we did the 5-year anniversary party. I think that one was down the road at over in Ravenswood, and then we did the one at Lincoln that I helped out with.
That on Fleek?
No, well, I can't remember what it was called.
Was it not,
Throw?
What
was it called Throw, Throw Party. Throw. Yeah, Half Acre Throw.
It wasn't
party.
Called On Fleek.
On Fleek.
Throw. Someone said Throw was yeah. On Fleek.
So the idea was like Half Acre like, Throw Party.
Yeah,
Throw. So they called it Throw.
Yeah.
And I remember like selling tickets for that. It was like walk up only at Lincoln. And like a certain point in the night, we had like awesome DJs. There was like all these cool different experiences, all these other cool breweries that were pouring there. And then, pardon me. one of my coworkers at the time worked in the shop at Lincoln and he plays drums in Oozing Wound. So it was like really fun, dancey party. And all of a sudden like a thrash band starts playing and so many people got super bummed out.
I remember that actually.
And then I don't know who it was, but someone passed out like 20 or 30 different joints and they were just like, all of a sudden it just turned into this like, they're playing a set on the brew house on the brew pad while like it's an insane amount of like pot smoke in the air, and it's like the party has shifted.
Right.
I remember like a certain point that night,
some thrash metal is taking over the vibe.
I remember a certain point that night, Gabriel's like, "Hey man, have a drink." And I'm like, "Bro, this is scotch." He's like, "Yeah, I know." And I was like, "This is not what I want to be drinking at all." Like what?
Yeah, that's a whole turn.
I know.
I remember from that part there were like white Jabberwocky face masks that people were wearing that freaked me out and I did not enjoy it at all.
So there was like instead of having like a disco ball spinning hanging in the brewery, there was like this huge like space bubble that had like a bunch of masks on it that were like spray painted different colors and stuff and like mm-hmm. lights were shining off of it. And there was always different like zones because at that point we had moved all the tanks up to the Balmoral space. So I was like, okay, yeah, we can do like one cool fun event here before we like, you know, add the kitchen and all that kind of stuff. And so we did that, but it was like, it was weird. It was like a intentionally kind of weird night. And I remember having a lot of fun at that one. Every single Big North was a blast to put together. But yeah, I think Far and Away was probably the tip of the, tip of the iceberg for me. I don't know if I'm saying like it was
so the peak. No,
the peak of the valley,
the pinnacle of the
the plateau.
Yeah, top the acme.
Yeah, it was definitely something that like I was glad to help facilitate for the people who bought tickets, the people who flew in, and the people who helped put it together. I think it all kind of came together in the most harmonious way.
That's awesome.
Yeah. It was great.
Best event I've ever been to, and so I think you did a great job.
Okay, thank you.
Since your time there, you're now the, what is your title at Phase 3? I don't want to get it wrong.
No, I know.
It's relatively new.
Well, no, it's kind of a, I'm in a in between.
Okay.
I've been given a promotion, but I've not been given a new job title yet. Okay. On paper, I manage our sales and distribution. So the role's kind of evolved from making invoices and helping getting the vans loaded to managing a team of salespeople, managing a network of distributors, managing, helping manage a production plan for a brewery, and all the stuff that comes with the beer selling.
So overall, what's been the biggest transition for you going from a brewery that had a pretty robust distributor to one that's like kind of self-distributed, and where I think probably a lot of your time at Half Acre, you're just saying no to people, right? Like you just kind of like didn't have enough beer a lot of the time.
Yeah. So we skipped over a huge part of my, I know this isn't like my biography by any means.
It kind of is.
So I worked there for 9 years. For 5 of those years, I did sales. Right. In Chicago.
Sorry, I just know you, so I just assumed other people would know that too. So
right.
Great. Thank you for hosting the show correctly.
No. So I bopped around in like manufacturing, production, shipping, receiving, social media, whatever, and then ended up doing sales before the production space was open. So going from, we brewed like 15,000 beers kind of like statically in 2012 and 2013 until we opened up the second facility in 2014. And we had like such higher demand than anything we were able to produce. So my first year doing sales was just saying no to people. But then from there, it kind of developed into, did sales, said no to people for a long time, and then started saying yes, developing the market, selling beer to more bars and restaurants locally, working with like a very hungry distributor at a time that they were able to really like crank and help turn that demand into sales for us, and helped us do that and took care of delivering the beer and the tap handles and everything in between. And then I kind of transitioned out of sales to help spend more time doing marketing, experiential marketing, events, samplings, managing a team of people to go do beer fests locally, nationally, et cetera. So I was kind of out of the sales game for like 3 or 4 years by the time I started managing sales and distribution again. And the number one thing that I took for granted wasn't just having a distributor. Like all they're doing is delivering the beer, and that's great. That's a very nice service. You pay for that service as someone who works with a distributor, and I think it's really wonderful. And I'm grateful for most of the people I've worked with in distribution. But the one thing I missed was having a flagship beer that would just like kind of almost without thinking take care of like 50% of the sales volume for us. So sure. Bringing it back to Daisy Cutter, like when I started working at Phase 3, it's like, man, I would love to have like a flagship beer that would just kind of be, selfless sales every single week. And we've kind of developed that with a few different beers, but I don't really know that there's going to be a lot of breweries in this day and age who can start in 2023 and have like something that was responsible for that much of their sales.
Sure.
But I miss that. I miss that. And also like the style of beer that we make is we've definitely, I don't know if that's my influence there or not. We've definitely been getting more into the classic styles of beer. But Haze still drives the production schedule for us.
Sure. I mean, at the time they started and what they're known for, it makes sense.
Yeah.
Like it should.
Right.
So having to work with so many rotating SKUs and self-distribution, what's the biggest differences for how you approach managing people, and what do you tell them to do to make sure you guys are still moving beer?
Well, a lot of that comes down to people wanting to buy it.
Sure. And you mean like pull through, like people at the end wanted to buy it.
Yeah. Well, that and, you know, retailers too. So something I took a lot of pride in on the sales side of things was building relationships and selling based off of relationships. You know, fostering a good network of people that you knew who you could go to with certain things when they came up, and selling from there. That was really huge for me to understand both at Half Acre and currently at Phase 3, because if people don't like you, even if the beer sells really well, like, who cares?
I mean,
if the beer, even if it's the best beer in the world, like if the person you're dealing with on a day-to-day basis is kind of a jerk or kind of like this is dismissive of you and takes you for granted, like, What's the point of giving that like
better be zombie dust?
If that I was actually talking to a friend who's a sales manager at Three Floyds last week, and he was like, you know, you're trying to get someone through your relationship and through your through trust to spend, you know, $500 to $1,000 of their money for their business every single week on your product, right, week after week after week, and like, trying to always make sure that they're cool with that and that they're on board with it. Like, that's where the experience and the finesse and the personality and that relationship really comes in. And I was like, you're right. You just don't even think about it.
Right.
But that
well, it's one of those, like, it's this water, like you're really personable and good at it. And so you don't give yourself the credit that that's how a lot of that was established, is that people, you're easy to like, you're not people, and those two things together make these relationships really strong.
Sure.
And but it's so natural that you're like, I didn't really do anything. It's like, no, you did do a lot.
Yeah. I don't think of it that I haven't really thought of it ever that way. I'm probably too aw shucks about all sure. of it. But I mean, there's some truth to that for sure. I think that was like one of the biggest lessons I learned was like, okay, well, I didn't really think of myself as a salesperson for such a long time. And
might be a strength to not think of yourself that way.
Probably.
Yeah.
Yeah. But if you think about the fact that you're selling yourself more than you're selling the product to people, I think people see that as a genuine, like a genuine relationship and a genuine reason to trust somebody.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm probably not even the best at it, but if I'm going to show up, I'm going to try to have a fun time, try to make it memorable for the person I'm interacting with. And, hopefully at the end of the day, you like the beer and want to buy it and carry it. And if not, like, that's cool. I get it. Maybe next time. But
well, I think you're one of the best at it. I'd buy beer from you.
Well, thanks, buddy. You should open more bars.
Well, I have zero currently, so.
Yeah, I know. That's what I'm saying. You should get a tap room.
And then just carry Phase
3
products.
Well, I mean, I'm saying, like, you can have guest beer, man.
Might sell some beer that way.
Yeah, exactly.
I want to talk about one thing that's really left field, but how did the Dust Brothers kind of thing start between you and I? I have a version of it that I've told myself, and I want to see if it's similar to your mind.
I couldn't even tell you, honestly. I wish I could. I would. So I feel like it was on this podcast, but I
think it was before that.
You do?
Yeah, I think we, like, the Dust Brothers, as they have become codified, is definitely on this podcast.
Sure.
But I remember talking to you, about working at Binny's.
Yeah.
And a lot of people coming in and asking if they had zombie dust.
Yeah.
if they had, and then asking if we had gumball head sometimes, but often gumball face. And then if we didn't have either of those, just going and buying Miller Lite.
I thought you were going to say Alpha King.
No, it's way better. And it's like, I probably only happened maybe one or two times, but in my head it happened 1,000 times. And then I don't know if this is true, but I remember you telling me a story about people asking you as the sales rep for Half Acre where, how they could get zombie dust.
I remember having to field that question too.
Yeah. Okay. So I didn't make that up.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then we both also liked it a lot.
But just think about that.
Yeah, yeah.
Think about the fact that people were chasing down a pale ale.
6% pale ale. Right, it's got Citra in it.
With Citra, obviously. Yeah. But people were like so fanatic about this beer. Like, I don't...
There's nothing like that.
I just don't think that's ever going to happen again.
No. And it wasn't just happening here, because my dad went to a liquor store in Connecticut, printed out the Rate Beer Top 100 that year, and asked them if they had West Vleteren 12.
Was it the one year they did distribute it?
No, it wasn't. It would have been awesome if he had that.
I know.
And then looked at the paper and then asked if they had zombie dust. And I think that might have been when it codified for me, like, this is something that's bigger than, like...
Yeah.
But we also genuinely loved the beer. It was like a... And it was one of those, like, if it's on draft, I get it kind of, times.
Yeah.
But I don't remember how it started on the show.
No, I don't either.
I think...
So, to bring it all full circle, I used to chase Daisy Cutter before I moved to Chicago. Like, I would go to a store. I would, like... I'm trying to think if, like, besides a Binny, like, I don't even think I knew about a Binny's then. Because even Binny's Marcy wasn't Binny's Marcy then. It was
Sam's,
right? So even, like, I don't even know that I knew where to go to get a beer like Daisy Cutter. So I would go to, like, the liquor store at Damon and just south of Roscoe, like Damon and School. I forget what, I don't even know. But I would, like, go in there and I'd be like, oh, they have Gossamer. I don't want that.
Yeah.
Get this out of here. Gross. I don't want Gossamer.
Golden
Daisy Cutter, yeah. You know? And like,
so
I remember.
You're the one who killed Gossamer. Do you also kill Overale?
I was actually, the first time Overale got canned, I was working the line at the time, and we didn't have, so we used to put all the Half Acre cans into like mother cartons, so like full cases. And we didn't have the cases in time for the cans. It was like, we got to get this beer out of the tank because we got to brew more Daisy Cutter.
Right.
So I remember canning it, and then we would like stack just four packs on four packs on four packs on a pallet, and we wrapped it. And at the time, the floor at Lincoln was so jacked up that like I hit a huge divot, and the entire pallet, we only stacked it, I think, four or five high, but I was probably 2 months into working there, and like just cans everywhere, so much cans damaged. And I was like, and that's how my career in beer ends. Like, I was so convinced, like, I'm gonna get fired by this. And they're like, no, dude, this is none of this is your fault.
Same story for the first run of Ninja versus Unicorn cans, actually, where like we didn't have cases for them, so they're just stacked.
Yep.
And Garrett, luckily it was the owner of the brewery, picks up this pal and just is like whipping around in these unfinished floors. We didn't have money to finish the floors, and sure enough, the first pallet off the line, 90% of it just down, gone, done. So you're not alone.
Yeah, it happens. I think it's insane to think about that. But it's also insane to think about like chasing a pale ale. But I was that guy. I was that guy.
Oh, for sure.
And then once I had like unlimited access to it, it was just like, I remember like after my job interview, like getting the job, I was like, oh, this is great. Oh, actually, to take it back a step, I don't think I'm talking out of school when I say that Half Acre learned and worked through a lot of problems and had a lot of issues, as any company does. And one of the things was the seamer at the time in late 2010. Yeah. They were having issues with their seamer. And I remember going to a liquor store in Wicker Park. I don't even know if it's there anymore, but I remember going and it was like a New Year's party, and I was like, oh, I'll take the daisy cutter. And like, yeah, the cans are leaking. And I was like, ah, it's fine. I'll drink it anyways. I didn't care.
I remember giving friends like half full growlers of daisy cutter, be like, look how good this is. And like, by the time I'd come around and they're like, what are you talking about? It was like flat and old, but I saved it for them. Right. But I'm like, I'll just have two out of it and I'll save it for these guys.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah. The good old days.
Yeah.
But I would, because I was in liquor stores in like 20, shoot, I'm trying to remember if it was 2013 or 2014 when I started doing sales. I guess it would have been 2013, end of 2013. It's like listening to paint dry. I'm so sorry. Putting all this together. But at the time, like 2013, 14, 15, I was in liquor stores every day, and I would see where Zombie Dust was going and when it was in stock and when it wasn't. And I remember like being at Binnie's where they would just like put a sign up over in the three flight section, like, yeah, we don't have Zombie Dust, sorry.
Yeah.
Or like they would take it down, but they wouldn't put it on the shelf. So it's like, if you want it, you got to ask the guy.
Right, right. They got one case.
Yeah, they got to ask the guy at customer service. And chasing down a pale ale was just like, that's what you did because that's what people wanted. And that's what people traded for too.
And there weren't infinite replacement level.
Exactly.
Pale ales. Like now it's like, it sounds absurd.
Right.
But there were a handful of actually really good hoppy beers, which sounds crazy because it's not that long ago, but it was true.
Yeah.
There were a handful that were like elite. And then like the only beer trade I ever made was a 6-pack of Zombie Dust for a 4-pack of Heady Topper.
That's the best. Yeah. That's the perfect trade.
Yeah, I'm some sort of made up simulation
one and
person.
Yeah, one and done.
I
like the you've executed the perfect trade.
Yeah, I mean, I've since like sent my own beer to people at breweries, have sent their beer back, but I don't think of it the same way. This is like I had my roommate go on Beer Advocate forums and see if anyone would trade me a 4-pack of Heady Topper for a 6-pack of Zombie Dust.
Yep.
And he was like, you got to throw in extras. And I was like, no, I don't have extras. Right. What are you talking about?
Right.
And then I drank the Heady Topper and I was like, this is fine. I'd rather have the 6-pack of Zombie Dust and never made another beer trade like that ever again in my life. but
to go back to Zombie Dust though,
should we revisit this? Or there's an empty stovepipe.
Right.
Should we? There's a little bit left. It's not fully empty. Should we finish it?
Sure. I prefer.
I don't know who was drinking this before. Maybe the guys who had the studio before us.
Oh yeah, they kind of scampered out of here in a hurry. A little less is fine. Thank you.
Can't take it out.
So I was actually at the Three Floyds 15 year anniversary party where they had Cenotaph.
Oh wow!
And I was there with the. One of the
did you ask him to fill a growler halfway?
one of the co-owners of Half Acre, and we had like the brewer's pass or whatever, so we had like unlimited Cenotaph at our disposal. And I remember drinking it all night, just going back, drinking it, then going to the stage, watching Melvin's play, and then like just hitting this keg hard. I think. We tapped 2 or 3 kegs of one beer that night from unlike the brewer's lounge. It was crazy.
Yeah.
And I remember when they made the change to Zombie Dust, me and that same brewery owner drove to Munster on a Friday to get a case of Zombie Dust to bring back to the brewery. So we're like, you guys, no, you got to try this beer. It's like awesome.
We also now joke like it's Citra. It's Citra. It's so ubiquitous, but it wasn't. Like it's a similar thing. Like it wasn't. There weren't just infinitely good hoppy brews.
Yep.
There also just wasn't access to Citra. I remember working at Pipeworks, and when they made Citra Ninja, it was because they got Citra in a lottery.
Really?
Because Boston Beer Company was auctioning off.
I remember that.
Or not auctioning off, but like lotterying off ingredients that they weren't going to use that they had in inventory. And they just gave them to, or let breweries buy them.
Wasn't that one of the highest rated beers for Pipeworks for a long time too?
It probably had Citra in it.
Yeah.
But
I just remember that was like one of those beers where like it got such a high score on Beer Advocate.
Yeah.
That people like went crazy for it. And then changing it from Citra Ninja to Pipework Citra.
It's Pipework Citra. All the art stayed the same and stuff, but we got a cease and desist for the word ninja.
Right. I remember Master Ski like posted highly of it. Okay, now it's on my radar.
The influential Master Ski.
Yeah, I know. He was like the first beer influencer for me just because I sound like a fossil, but you think about those influential people, and as someone who like used to have an Untappd account just to like keep track of the beers I would drink and whatnot and what was memorable. But even, you know, predating that, seeing like someone like Master Ski who would like go and do these reviews of beers, it was like, you paid attention to what he said. You like watch, I remember like watching him in the Lincoln shop posting typing out on a BlackBerry a review of a beer out of like a 3 ounce plastic cup.
Long Tie Rainbow Rye.
Yeah, probably that or like some other Ambrosia.
Ambrosia.
Some like I think the thing that like looking back.
Tasty Waves.
Oh man, Tasty Waves. That was a beer. That was one of those beers that like I actually helped. I've never been a brewer. I homebrewed two or three batches, but I feel like I could try to guide something conceptually. I remember Tasty Waves was one of the first beers where they're like, yeah, let's do it. Let's give it a shot.
That's awesome.
And that was my name too. I didn't do the design, but I was like, one of the movies I watched probably way too young, way too often was Fast Times at Ridgemont High. And Tasty Waves came from that.
That's awesome.
The name came from that. So
was that a Citra Pale Ale?
I don't remember. I don't think it was a Citra Pale Ale. I think it was like, I think the idea, the initial concept was Gossamer malt with like Daisy Cutter hops, which at the time I think was like Amarillo, Centennial, and then I don't know what else. I think that this beer, probably Columbus or Cascade. I couldn't even tell you, now that it's been a few years, I couldn't even tell you the hops that are in this beer anymore. I'm sure it's changed.
The first time I took the tour, Gabriel was giving it. And I was like 20. I was like 21 and like a month old.
Yep.
And I asked him specific hops, and he just like refused to. Like, really? Yeah, he just wouldn't tell me. And he's like, "Why are you asking me this?" I'm like, "Well, I wanted to know. I googled hops on the internet. This is what came up."
Yeah. I know that like the first summer I worked there, we were getting garbage something, and it
probably Amarillo crop varies a lot.
I just remember the beer tasted so oniony, and I was like, "Man, this sucks." And we would brew a batch, we'd package it, send it to the distributor, and then like a day and a half later, the distributor would be like, "Hey, you got any more?" I'd be like, "No, we just sent you all of it, every drop." And they'd be like, "Yeah, we sold it in a day." And they'd be like, "Well, okay," and like we were always up against that like constant battle. So it was throw whatever hops we have around in the beer, not like just throw them in whatever, but if you committed to like a certain crop, like this is probably before this is like not factual, I'm just guessing, but I don't know that we were traveling to Yakima to do hop selection in those days.
It wasn't such a thing for smaller breweries,
so it was just like we got what we got, and I remember just like we had to put out oniony Daisy Cutter and no one cared at
sure.
all. Yeah. It was just like it sold faster than it ever had. I was like, "How is no one mentioning this?" Like, oh, whatever, you know. So
still good.
Yeah.
I think when our Zombie Dust friendship really solidified, though, is one day I was driving from Pipeworks in a company van here to do a delivery, and you were going the opposite direction.
Yes. On Belmont.
And you had texted me first that they had you were here.
Yes.
And that they had Zombie Dust.
I remember this.
And we were driving down Belmont.
Yeah.
And I saw you and you honked at me. And you tried to give me a Zombie Dust out the window while our cars were moving.
Right.
And I got scared because I didn't want to like sideswipe. And I pulled away.
Yeah.
And that's when I decided to just be as open as possible to you and not pull away from you anymore.
Sure. Well, I appreciate
that.
I didn't
want to break my arm. But
do you also think about like how much damage we could have done?
Yeah, a lot. A lot.
Like, so ignorant.
Well, I was in a van too, and I think you were in a sedan.
Yeah, I've had a Honda Civic forever. So
I'm a small person, so I have short arms. So I couldn't reach it.
Right.
But...
I have long arms.
One of my biggest regrets in life is that I did not get that beer.
I'm so glad you didn't. Because I think about like the chances of success of that are so slim. It was a Sacramento and Belmont.
But just like far and away, you still have to try for things that where success might be low. But yeah, it was Sacramento and Belmont.
I remember.
And also, it's good because if I had actually like gotten that in my hand, I would have had to drink it while I was driving.
So I don't know.
And you can't do that.
That's not a good idea.
It's a really bad idea.
I don't want to like get too behind the curtain here, but there was a very, very, very long, long text thread with Mike and Chris and myself. It was just pictures of me in front of cases of zombie dust in liquor stores. And I did it for years and years and years. And I personally loved it every single time. I thought it was so funny every single time.
And it was.
and it's kind of devolved from there. But anytime I like am out and about now, because I'm, you know, the evolution of our careers, we don't spend as much time in the market. At least I don't.
I guess you do. Unless I'm dropping the beer off, I'm barely ever out.
Right. But you're out there.
I'm out here.
I'm almost never out there. I need to be out there more for sure.
And to find these zombie cases.
I know. I gotta find this dust.
Well, when it really turned is when we were in Mariano's and there was like a fake pallet of zombie dust. Yeah. That was my favorite. It was upside down empty cases of zombie dust. That's maybe the only like peace sign up, look at me in these zombie dust cases I've sent back. It was just at Mariano's with it on sale in a pallet and being like, we've really made it, boys.
It was one of those things where like you'd go to Whole Foods and they would just like, all the Whole Foods beer that's not on an end cap use. I don't know if this is still the case, but it'd always be in a cooler. It'd always be cold stored, which is great.
Mm-hmm.
And they wouldn't even bother with zombie dust. They just put like a case or two in front of the cooler, be like, all right, have at it, guys.
Yeah.
And people, like, it would just get torn apart.
Yeah.
And I remember like taking a photo in front of one of those and not like almost instantly after taking the photo, this guy like reached in. And, like,
it would have been so great if his hand was in it.
I know. Used to be like a limit 1 6-pack per person type of beer too.
Well, the only time in my tenure that the ILCC came to Pipeworks was a guy who came to quote unquote like check in our invoices, make sure we had all the, because we were self-distributed, so like that you have to have a physical copy of all the invoices. Yep. Or like he came and he's like, oh, do you have your invoices for these dates? And I was like, sure, here. And we had them. We actually had a pretty good filing system. It's chaotic as that place was. Sure. Like the stuff they can like take your license for, let's organize that.
What a concept.
So he's going through this like pile of invoices and clearly not looking at them or caring. He has no reference. He's not like referencing something that might have happened.
Sure.
And he's like, hey, do you guys know anything about Three Floyds? And of course I'm like, zombie dust is great. He's like, yeah, zombie dust is great. Have you guys heard anything about like the prices for that? And it was just like a guy who had shown up to try to get information about potential like price fixing of zombie dust cases.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
It had nothing to do with us.
Sure.
They never said that, but it was just all he asked about was like, this place says, you know, do you ever tell them how much they're supposed to charge for this? Yep. And he pulled out the invoice, like, no, we just give them the invoice. And like,
right.
Have you heard of anyone doing that? And I was like, no. Like, right. Also, if we did, like, I'm not going to tell you.
I'm still really good friends with the person who was the sales director there at the time.
Yeah.
And, you know, them having to navigate that was insanely frustrating because they would go to their distributor and be like, hey, stop selling beer to this account because they're charging $20 for a 6-pack of this.
Can you imagine beer? A $20 4-pack?
Or
crazy.
Yeah, I know.
I heard they just got Trillium here actually today.
Today, yeah. 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 But they sure did.
It's $40 4-packs. How times have changed.
How about it?
Yeah. Well,
I don't think they're at Far and Away.
Trillium.
Yep.
Did they say no, or did you not invite them?
I feel like we invited them for sure.
They were too cool for you.
I don't know that they
responded. Trieste didn't come either.
I don't know if we invited them.
Hill Farmstead.
We did invite them, Matt. I mean,
just got a no coast bias
but,
here.
But also, like, we used to like trade backdraft beers with them.
Right.
And when I started at Half Acre, that was a thing. Like, we would send them Sixel of Daisy Cutter, they would send back a Sixel of Edward, and that was just like part of the thing, because one of the owners had family in Vermont and
right.
spent time out there, and that was just like how that came to be. I didn't even right. think that they were, like, you know, a big deal.
Right. And it was like a noble quantity of breweries, right? Where it's
exactly
like, we make really good beer, you make really good beer, let's yeah. trade.
We did the same there thing with Curtin. Like,
Carton
Brewing
in New Jersey.
Yep.
They have a competing podcast, so we don't talk about them.
They do. I'll leave it at
just,
that.
I'm just kidding. Getting fresh Sixels of Edward.
Yeah.
For Daisy Cutters.
For free.
The first time I had Edward, it was at the festival in Worcester. And someone who worked for the distributor there was like, this is really good, but it's no Daisy Cutter.
Really?
Yeah. I was like, yeah, you're right. We get Daisy Cutter all the time.
Right.
And I was dating our mutual friend at the time, and so I did get free Daisy Cutter all the time.
Right.
Great.
That's the best.
Beer that changed your life, Daisy Cutter.
It sure is.
Yeah.
That's why I'm here.
I'm grateful. For better or for worse.
No, I mean, it really, at the end of the day, I think that if our friendship is what came out of this beer being in my life, then it was important and life-changing for sure. So.
Yeah. Well, I do love you, Eric.
I love you too, buddy.
All right.
Thanks for having me on.
Thanks for being on.
I appreciate it. Remember, this is what we wanted. Remember, this is what we said. To never be heard or seen from again. Remember, this is what we wanted.